Good afternoon to everybody. The seminar of today is about sensors based on organic molecular materials, and the speaker is Dr. Raphael Fattner. Dr. Fattner studied physics at Graz University of Technology, Austria, working on polymer field effect transistors during his master's degree. In 2007, he joined Nanomol at the Instituto of Scienza de Materiales de Barcelona in Spain for his doctoral degree in material science. From 2014 to 2017, he worked in California at Stanford University on plastic electronics and the development of an artificial electronic skin. Since 2017, he continued his research on organic electronics at the ICMAP. During this time, he made several other short research visits in both national and international research facilities. Dr. Fattner's main research interests include organic metals, organic semiconductors, organic field defect transistors, change transport, and sensors. So, if you are ready, Raphael, you can share your screen and start with the presentation.
Thank you very much for this very nice introduction and the opportunity to talk to you. It's a very nice possibility to share some of the research we have been carrying out. Actually, as Sara just mentioned, I am working in Barcelona in Nanomol, and this is a relatively big group with many people from many different backgrounds, from chemistry to physics to engineering. So I really like the environment because in these fields, it's very important to speak with people from many different formations because you can learn many, many things. So as Sara already introduced, today I would like to share some results on sensing with molecular crystals, organic metals, and semiconductors. I would like to start the presentation with a very brief introduction where I would like to try to introduce a little bit what's an electrical resistance and what we do mean by that, because this will be important to understand some of the sensors that I would like to discuss. Don't be afraid by these fancy names like piezo-resistive, for example, no, because this one is just a very strange word to say a deformation sensor, a sensor that changed its resistance when we deform it. Or pyroresistive, for instance, is just a sensor that can change with temperature. The hydroresistive, as you may imagine, is just another word for a humidity sensor. When I was preparing the seminar, I was thinking, well, how to introduce electrical resistance? And when I was looking through Google, actually, I found this interesting picture. And I think it depicts pretty well what happens in a material, or let's say what engineers or physicists believe that happens in a material. We think that there is this guy over here called Mr. Ohm that can control the thickness of a channel in a conductor. And then if Mr. Volt pushes the current through, it will depend on how thick this channel is. So in simple words is that this electrical resistance is responsible how easy the electricity can flow in materials. Now, there is different possibilities. An insulator, for instance, is a material that has a very high electrical resistance. And this I did show here schematically with an R with an arrow that goes up. Examples for these materials, for instance, could be glass or silicon oxide. I put here an example of a drinking glass. That's an insulator. Another class of materials are semiconductors. They have usually an intermediate electrical resistance, and examples could be, for instance, silicon or germanium. Also here, an example, this is a picture of a piece of germanium. Metals probably are most known to, is better known to most of you, and those materials typically have an electrical resistance which is very, very low. examples could be copper, gold, silver. I also put an example here of a small piece of copper, gold, sorry. So if you look at the insulator semiconducting metal, for instance, in Google, then you will see a schematic that is depicted over here. Don't worry, I will not go into detail into device physics or engineering, but people working in this field usually like to describe how electricity flows by using some bands or some energy states that are separated by a gap. We usually say that an insulator is defined if this gap is bigger than 3 electron volts. Now, this number looks a little bit arbitrary, but if you think about it, materials with a wider band gap than 3, they are transparent. And this is no coincidence, I think, because we humans do actually see colors with a wavelength from deep purple to dark red. So this is very nicely in agreement with this definition we use to divide from an insulator to semiconductor to a metal. But from a more practical point of view, if you want to know what a material's electrical resistance is, you can buy a multimeter, very cheap nowadays, and you connect 2 electrodes to your sample, and then very conveniently, you can read already the electrical resistance on a display, for instance. Now, if you want to do some science, we could think about what happens if we change the temperature. So if we heat the material, if we have to deal with a metal, then we will see that upon increasing the temperature, this metal resistance will increase. While if we have a semiconducting material, at a higher temperature, its electrical resistance will be smaller. There is another class of materials in between those two, and those are called semi-metals. They are very interesting because their electrical resistance does not seem to change much with temperature. At NanoMol, we work on tetra-tiafulvalent derivatives. Don't worry, I will not ask you to remember this complicated name, but I still decided to put one of these molecular structures on the slide because they depict how we believe, or at least how we think, that these materials could look like at the very small level. You will see here these side groups R will permit us to modify these materials so we can change their properties. One very interesting properties of those materials is that we can grow crystals from solution. In a crystal, these molecules order in a very organized fashion, and then this helps for the electricity to flow through, as I mentioned at the very beginning, very easily. These crystals, as you can see here on this picture, are deformable, soft, but if you check the scale bar, they are around the same thickness or even thinner than a human hair. So, okay, they are really small and they are fragile, but you mentioned something before, or I mentioned something before, that I'm going to make sensors with them. So how are we going to do that? Something that's tiny, little, and fragile will break. It will not work as a sensor, right? So the big question is, can we process them in a more efficient way? And the answer to that is, yeah, actually we can, because we can prepare B-layer films, as we call them. They consist of a polymeric matrix with a topmost polycrystalline layer. This is Professor Elena Laukina, an expert in the field, and she's holding a small piece of one of these B-layer films in her hands. This is another example of a small piece after fabrication with a tweezer in the laboratory. So actually what we actually succeed in this way is we could include in this polymer these molecular conductors, so this crystalline layer, and could prepare a flexible, light, and transparent material that has a relatively good room temperature resistance. So essentially we could combine the electrical performance of these fragile tiny little crystals with the processing properties of the insulating polymers. So in simple words, we could make a plastic bag conductive. And that's something very interesting, because now we can start to play making sensors. So we can cut small pieces of this plastic bag and try to see what type of sensors we can make. Let's start with the first example. Let's try to make something to measure deformation. In order to do that, we cut a small piece of this plastic and we mount it between two electrodes. And then we deform, or we stretched these electrodes in a horizontal direction, as shown here. In this picture over here, you can see that in blue, this is the elongation. It's around 20 micrometers. It's very small. But the electrical resistance change follows very nicely. We can repeat this for really long times, almost up to 10 hours, and there is almost no degradation. If we plot the change of the resistance as a function of this elongation, we see a very nice linear response. And in very depth analysis, we checked actually the crystal softness and the crystal structure of these materials with a technique called XRD analysis, which I will describe a little bit later in more detail in the humidity sensors. This is actually a technique that allows us to measure the distance between the molecules. And what we saw is that when we deform these films, we change these intermolecular distances. So we take the molecules a little bit more far apart. And this is responsible for this nice resistance change we see. They are really, really sensitive. So we were thinking about applications, and we developed a first prototype. That's me, almost 10 years ago, where we actually mounted a small piece of these films between copper contacts, and then mounted it on top of my chest. And we tried to record, or actually we succeeded, my breathing rhythm. So in these first few cycles, I was breathing normally. Then I did take a really big breath. Then I was breathing normally. Then again, a really big breath. And then normally, and then I stopped breathing. Luckily, my heart didn't stop. So if we zoom in here, we could even resolve the pulse rate when I was stopped breathing. And after that, I continued breathing normally. So this is a very simple first prototype of a device that could be used to monitor human health care, for instance. Another type of devices that we have been playing with are these fancy called bioresistive response materials. It's just a fancy word for a temperature sensor. So if we change the chemical composition or the crystal structure of this topmost crystalline layer in these plastic bags, we can change the electrical resistance. And more interestingly, we can change this called temperature resistance coefficient, which is nothing more than how sensitive they are to changes of temperature. And in fact, this picture is very similar to the schematic I mentioned at the very beginning of the talk. We can tune the temperature response of these materials from semiconducting, shown in green, which shows a lower resistance at higher temperature, to semi-metallic, that almost does not change with the temperature, to metal, which increases the resistance with temperature. Now, this is really interesting because all of them are also sensitive to deformation, but imagine you could use the red one and make a deformation sensor, which shows the same response at all temperatures. So we can try to think about selective sensors. Now, more easily, we could also just put the green sensor on top of a surface. And this would allow us to directly measure the temperature of this surface. But we have been trying to make something even more fancy. So we tried to develop, or we made, a bolometer. This is sounds to be a very complicated name, but it's a device that looks like a little bit like a UFO. But let me try to explain what this device does. Actually, it was invented a long time ago, 1878, by Professor Langley. And it's nothing more than a heat radiation detector, or in other words, a very sensitive temperature sensor. How does this thing work? actually it's able to absorb. So there is one of these plastic films suspended, and this one can absorb light shining on top of this film. This light could be, as I mentioned in the introduction, visible. It could be red, green, red, could be infrared, light that we humans cannot see anymore, or even heat emitted by a human body. And what happens actually is that this radiation heats locally this plastic. This heat is transmitted to the crystals, and the crystals, as I mentioned before, we can measure their resistance. So we made a small setup to try if this complicated explanation actually could work. So we made a hot plate where we can control from a computer its temperature. And then at a 1 meter distance, we mounted one of these films and checked if we can actually see the temperature change of this hot plate. And if we do so, we did different combinations of different materials and different setups. But essentially what we see is that at a higher temperature, this resistance starts to change. So we can actually, at a distance, without touching the hot plate, determine its temperature. Now, as you see here, this is around 100 degrees, okay? So that's not very interesting. So we were thinking, okay, maybe we can try to measure something else. And we took one of these pieces out again. We mounted it on a small holder and then connected some electronics to it. And then we're measuring the electrical resistance when I approach with my hand. So whenever the hand goes closer, the resistance goes down. Then it comes up back again. Then the hand approaches, it goes down. So the resistance gets smaller when the hand is heating this tiny little film. We can back calculate after calibration the temperature, and we could see that locally this film was heated only for 100 millikelvin. That's a very small number. So they are very, very sensitive temperature sensors, in fact. Now, this brings me already to the last example of sensors or films that we use to prepare, in this case, humidity sensors. Again, similar as before, we used a polymeric matrix, and on top we grow this crystalline layer that is actually sensitive to the humidity. Now, when we analyze this, we get this picture over here shows an XRD spectrum. And that's something interesting because in this case, scientists can use XRD, which is a very short wavelength, to measure the distance between the molecules. And interestingly, when we measured kind of the signature of our sample, we saw different peaks, different group of peaks, green, red, and blue. And we could actually analyze them. And what we found is that there were much smarter people before us that actually did grow this type of materials individually and then analyze them very careful with XRD measurements. And they could measure the distances and how these molecules arrange. This schematic over here actually shows nicely how these calculations, so when what they found out, they published in these papers, and then they submitted it to a database where now we can access. So we have a more clear picture how the molecules actually orientate, and we can check that these same signatures can be found in our films. So now we know that we have two different phases, and our films are made up with these molecules. They arrange in this way, right? So there is the molecule. This is bromine, and there is some water in between. Now, we wanted to see if this works as a humidity sensor. We had the suspicion that this could work. So we prepared different films with water molecules included in the crystal structure, but we checked it to compare with different molecules that they don't have these water molecules inside. And as we expected, that only those with coordinating water molecules in the crystal structure show a response to humidity. The others were not responsive. This is very nice again because we can try to make selective humidity sensors. we tried the reversibility and the stability. So on top of over here, you can see the change of the resistance. And at the same time, below, we measured the change of relative humidity. So you can see very nicely how the resistance now follows the relative humidity. Now, okay, the humidity sensor seems to work, but we wanted to figure out and understand why or how it is working. So we reached out to a very nice group, a specialist in XRD at the CNR in Bologna, and they were actually very good at measuring, as I mentioned before, this distance between the molecules. And what we decided actually was that we wanted to measure this distance between the molecules at different humidity. So what we did is we started to record spectra of these films and expose them to different humidity levels. We started at very dry conditions at 10% and then went all the way up to 80%. And then from 80%, we did go back to 10 to dry again. And in fact, this one over here is just a zoom out of this first region over here. And we can see that this peak slightly shifts to lower values and then slightly comes back to the same position as before. And this full reversibility, we attribute to this humidity response. The second peak, as you can see, is not responsive to change of humidity. So there is no change going on. Now, as I mentioned before, we could actually try, or we did calculate this distance, right? So if we take from these figures over here, we can extract the distance. And this is shown over here. So at a higher and higher level of humidity, we see that this distance, this corresponds to the distance between the molecules. Starts to increase. And then if we go back again to dry conditions, we go back to the initial point. So this shows us the microscopic structural change of these crystals. While electrically, we can measure with the multimeter, for instance, at a different relative humidity, we see a different electrical resistance. And this is, for instance, the macroscopic electrical change. Now, the interesting part in this too is that we can correlate these two, because it would not be very practical to carry around an X-ray machine. They are very heavy and very expensive. So this is very difficult to measure. But electrically, with the multimeter, we can measure the electrical resistance change very nicely. So in this work, we are actually able to correlate that at higher humidity, water is going between the molecules, changing the distance between those molecules, and this is responsible for the change of the electrical resistance. With this, I already arrived to the summary and the conclusion. So I hope I could convince you that the bilayered films allow us to combine the very nice electrical properties of fragile small crystals with processing properties of polymers. In fact, we showed a few examples. One is a deformation sensor, one is a very sensitive temperature sensor, and the third and the last one was a very sensitive humidity sensor. Those materials, they show very interesting, fascinating electronic and structural transitions, and I just mentioned three examples. But we are currently also looking into others. So this is a very versatile set of materials to measure strain, which is just another word for measuring deformation, pressure, temperature, light, radiation, and humidity. With that, I would like to thank many people, because of course this cannot be done by one person alone. So I would like to thank Nanomol at ICMAPCSIC, and especially also our specialist collaborators in XRD at the CNR in Bologna. And of course, also thank you very much for your attention. And sorry for the interruption at the beginning due to the technical problems.
Okay, so thank you, Rafael, for your interesting presentation. And now it's the time for questions. I'll begin reading the ones already in the chat. So, the first, Can you use the same principle as the hydroresistive sensor to measure concentration of other gases, such as carbon monoxide or dioxide? It would be interesting to have smart windows that tell you when it's time to change air in your room.
Oh, thank you very much. This is actually a very nice idea and a very, very interesting question. I think it could be possible if we were able to find a crystal structure that is responsive to one of those gases that were mentioned. No, in case of the humidity sensor, to be honest, we were lucky because this crystal structure changes with humidity, and this is the important part behind it. No, then we were able to process it in a more convenient way. But if there is a crystal structure that is sensitive, let's say, to the gas or to the material you want to detect, I think it's feasible. Maybe with a little bit of work, it's possible to prepare something like this. And yeah, it's a very nice suggestion. It could be very interesting to try.
Okay, thank you. The second question, molecular materials are known to be structurally anisotropic. Is this the same for the sensing response? In other words, is the sensing response affected by the crystalline orientation?
Yes, of course it is. And I did not go into detail in this case, but what we actually have in this case is they are very well ordered perpendicular to the surface, but they are randomly oriented in AB, right? So we have a random superposition in AB. And this makes the deformation response anisotropic. If you take one single crystal, it will heavily depend if you measure vertically, horizontally, or the other way, right? So this, in a certain point, could also be used as differential measurements in a sense that we could try to make it sensitive only in one direction. But you're completely correct. So they are highly anisotropic. And that's why also is another very, very important part of it. That's also why they're so interesting, I think. Thank you very much for this question.
Okay, so more questions, just curiosity too. Don't be shy. Okay, waiting if there are more questions. I have two curiosities too. Okay, the first, you talked about the flexibility of semiconductors. So, if they are flexible, is there any limit for these properties or no?
Yeah, this is actually a very good point. And this is also a little bit a drawback of it, I think, because we have seen that if we deform them less than 0.5%, then they are elastic. Let's say they go back to the place they were. If you deform them more, then you deform them plastically. They don't go back. But the interesting part is that in low deformation, there seems to be a very high resolution. We measured down to 10^-3%. So this is strange numbers that is difficult to understand. But if I can put it a little bit in context, if we take 5 millimeter lengths of film, 10^-3% corresponds to 50 nanometers. So if we make a film 5 millimeter, we can resolve 50 divided by 1 with 9 zeros. That's a very, very, very high resolution. So I think what we lose with stretchability, we will probably never be able to do a stretchable sensor with them. But I think we can compensate with high resolution on the other side.
Okay, thank you, Rafael. And another more general question. After 50 years of research on organic materials to replace the silicon-based electronics, do you think that is there still a future for organic electronics?
Of course, but I think maybe some people won't agree with me, but I think we started on the wrong foot. The idea was never to replace silicon. Why should we replace something that works so well? To compare, I think to compete with silicon oxide or silicon-based materials, germanium and inorganic electronics was never the intention, or why should we replace something that works so really nice, right? But I think there is many, many possibilities for organic electronics, especially in human interface electronics. For instance, there has been very, very nice developments for reading physiological signals of humans, for instance, for healthcare applications. Then stretchability, some of those materials we can try to make stretchable sensors, which would be probably never be possible with inorganic materials. So yeah, I think there is still a bright future, but the problem is it's difficult. It's still a very, very new field, and but I'm pretty convinced that there is many niche applications or other technologies where we can use these materials where other materials can simply not work. Yeah, I think still they have a bright future.
Oh, you can, it doesn't work? Okay.
Okay. Now, yes. I don't know. Yeah. I have problems too with the connection today, the particular day. Sorry.
Hopefully it's not my fault. I don't know, but.
Okay. So if there aren't more questions or curiosities, I'll introduce you the seminar of next week. The title is Probing Crystal Dynamics by Low Frequency Raman Spectroscopy, presented by the Dr. Tommaso Salzillo from the Department of Chemical and Biological Physics at the Weizmann Institute of Science. And thank you another time, Rafael, for your availability. And thank you, all of us, for your kind attention. See you next Thursday.
Thank you very much for a nice opportunity, and I hope you enjoyed the seminar. I enjoyed it. Thank you very much for everything.